Thank you very much. I'm indeed very honored to be invited to this forum, and I'm very happy to be here. The title of my talk is, I've added a subtitle to my, the title of my talk, and it was called Thinking Beyond the Nation, Reimagining India. So I just have to prepare a paper, I will commit and we can have questions. The idea of reimagining India is meant to question the givenness of something called India, so that we do not start with beliefs in an always already existing closed community. Nation states have histories. They came into being in Europe in the 18th century, in India in the 19th. The anti-colonial nationalist movement in India evolved or called equally a territory that was supposed to have existed from time immemorial. The nationalist myth, whether secular Nehruvian or Hitlerian, involved the idea of an Indian nation formed over thousands of years. With independence, the assumption was that no further questioning on the basis of identity or on the basis of inequitable access to resources was required. This is what explains the crime of sedition in Indian law, which means literally the attempt to excite disaffection towards the government established by law in India. That's the crime of sedition, section 124A of the Indian Penal Code, which was introduced by the British colonial government in 1860. This provision continues absolutely unchanged, except for removing terms like Her Majesty and Crown Representative. So section 124A, apart from these few cosmetic changes, has remained unchanged for the last 150 years, and it rests on the assumption that once independence happens, no further questioning is possible. The existence of a nation is a daily plebiscite, said historian Hans Renan, a staunch supporter of the nation form. Not so Rabindranath Tagore, who was highly suspicious of what he calls a fetish of nationalism. He called the nation nothing but the organization of politics and commerce, and warned that when this nation becomes all-powerful at the cost of the harmony of the higher social life, then it is an evil day for humanity. So, very simply, I'm beginning my talk with this assertion that the charge of sedition has no place in democracy, it is anti-constitutional, it is anti-democratic, and must be repealed as soon as possible. There have been several attempts on the parts of several groups of people country over the last few decades to repeal section 124A, and efforts to repeal this archaic colonial provision must be. Today I will look at two kinds of challenges to the project of the Indian nation state that can and do attract the provision of sedition. The first is what I'm going to call counter-nationalisms, and the second is resistances to what is called development. Counter-nationalism. The idea of India has been a deeply contested one from the moment of its emergence in the 19th century. There are regions and peoples residing in the territory that came to be called India, which have histories autonomous of the Indian nation state, and which had independently negotiated relationships with the British colonial government, Manipur for example, and Nagaland. One of the significant achievements of the nation building elite of what subsequently became India was the incorporation into the Indian nation of these and regions at varying degrees of difference. The hegemonic drive, the anti-imperialist struggle, as well as the coercive power of the Indian state after independence, was deployed to enforce the idea of India as a homogeneous nation with a shared culture. Its very diversity was supposedly its strength, the popular nationalist motto being, as we know, unity in the West. However, the idea that all the multiple identities and aspirations in the landmass called India are ultimately merely little rivulets flowing into the mainstream of the Indian nation was never an unchallenged one. The project of nation building, therefore, several decades down the line, continues to be a fraught exercise. We all know that the northeastern region of India and Kashmir are well-known flashpoints. However, it would be misleading to assume that these two well-known quote-unquote trouble spots on the borders of India are unique instances of the crisis of the nation state. So let me consider some other instances that illustrate the perpetual anxiety generated by the need to preserve a nation, which is, we must remember, assumed to be simultaneously eternal and perpetually under threat of discipline. regulation status produced, it is presumed to be simultaneously eternal. That is, it is eternal, it has lasted from the beginning of time and it will last forever. But yet, the anxiety is it can break up any time. And we have to stop people from breaking up. So there's a belief that it is eternal and it is fraught with the anxiety that it will break up. So this is the paradox of the condition, that it is eternal but it can break up. So let's take actually a couple of issues from other parts of India which illustrate how fragile this condition of nationhood is and why it is and should be considered to be what are now called a plebiscite. So let's take the issue of linguistic reorganization of states, which was a long-standing commitment of the Congress leadership prior to India. It was recognized that the British government's rationale for forming provinces was purely that of colonial power. The Motilal Nehru Committee report of 1928 therefore held that the linguistic unity of the area should govern redistribution of provinces. After independence, however, the Linguistic Provinces Commission set up in 1947 rejected the idea, warning that the assertion of linguistic identities could jeopardize the unity of the Indian. The nationalist leadership as a whole was opposed to such states. So you understand, I presume, what I mean by linguistic reorganization of states. Malayalam speaking regions from Kerala, Tamil speaking regions from Tamil Nadu, etc. So it was supposed to be such a scary idea, such a frightening thought for the nationalist community, that the fear was that if you allow the assertion of linguistic identities, it will lead to the balkanization of India. This was what was said. For example, by Krishna Menon, who said we will balkanize India, we will split up India, we will break it into tiny bits if we dismember the state, the country into linguistic states. However, the popular movement fostered rethinking. The movement for Telugu speaking Andhra Pradesh, which began with Gandhian fasts in 1951, turned to mass violence in 1952, and the state of Andhra Pradesh was formed in 1953. The state of Telangana, as you know, was further formed from Andhra Pradesh. After movements for language-based states developed, mobilizing all the passion and emotive, Andhra Pradesh was formed in 1953, and other movements for language-based states developed, mobilizing all the passion and emotiveness associated with nationalist centers. The fear of the nationalist leadership at the center that linguistic provinces would have a subnational bias that should strain a nation still in its infancy seemed to be appropriate because of those sentiments that were aroused, people were immolating themselves for linguistic and language-based states. But nevertheless, the mass-based these sentiments had the backing of regional leaders, and finally the States Reorganization Act of 1956 created language-based states. Since then, there have been many other new states created under pressure from mass movements, and these are no longer now on the basis of language but of other kinds of things. So you have Uttarakhand from UP, Chhattisgarh from MP, Jharkhand from Bihar, and of course now Telangana from Andhra Pradesh. So that is one instance I'm giving you of a kind of what appeared to be a challenge to the nation state was the linguistic reorganization of states. You have, which makes us think, so what is the argument that I'm making? That it is about a daily person. If there is a mass popular movement, it has to be taken seriously and it has to be addressed. So one kind of issue was linguistic, language-based states, which was supposed to do something so terrible to India and didn't really. Now, take another very interesting issue which continuously poses a question mark over the idea of one national India. And this is the innumerable and continuing disputes over water sharing between states, which go beyond bickering between state governments alone. They often take a popular form. And they are another indicator that the idea of India cannot be assumed but must be subject to a daily website. One instance of this is the Kaveri water dispute between Tamil Nadu and Karnataka, which has resulted in rioting and violence against Tamilians in Karnataka in 1991. The Karnataka government refused to abide by the Supreme Court directive in 2002 to release water to Tamil Nadu. This is an ongoing kind of dispute, sharing of the waters of the river Kaveri. Another ongoing dispute is between Kerala and Tamil Nadu, the Mulaperiyar Dam of Periyar River. The dispute arises from an agreement between the British government of Madras Presidency, which is now in Tamil Nadu, and the princely state of Travancore, which is now part of it. Significantly, the opposition of the Tamil Nadu's right to Periyar waters is sometimes expressed in the language of independent nation states. That the colonial government had arm-twisted Travancore into an agreement that was disadvantageous to it, but today Kerala should consider its own interests first. So what I'm trying to say is that this kind of nationalist language comes very easily to different kinds of groups in the country. So when Kerala and Tamil Nadu are talking about water sharing, or when Karnataka and Tamil Nadu are talking about water sharing, they are not talking about it just government to government. People's identities get mobilized. So for water sharing, there are riots against Tamil Nadu, Tamilians in Karnataka, for example, or vice versa. And the language is that nationalist language that is happening. Now, of course, river sharing can be carried out cooperatively, and there are numerous instances of this too. But when such agreements take place, they have local interests at the core, not those of a large abstract identity called India. When you have resolution of these issues, it is at the local level. It's not for something abstract called India, it's because it's for the people of the country. Take the state of Tamil Nadu and its politics. And this offers another fascinating example of the complex relationship to India that most of its constituents have. The anti-government rebellion movement, that is the overwhelming political force in the state, was flamboyantly secessionist right up to the 1960s. When the threat of being banned under Nehru's legislation of 1963 made many of the parties modulate their demand, Tamil Nadu never felt part of India. There was a very powerful secessionist kind of sentiment in Tamil Nadu, including very fierce hatred towards the position of India as a language. But when the Indian state started coming down very strongly, then the parties began to modulate their demands. But over the decades, the politics of the state continues to assert Tamil cultural nationalism and to organize militantly against the imposition of India. The politics of a pan-Tamil identity plays out in continuing links at one time with the LTTE of Srikantha. It was always being reported that secessionist Tamil nationalist groups with links to LTTE are mushrooming in Tamil Nadu. These kind of reports you will hear in the papers. It was supposedly with the aim of an independent Tamil movement, including the Tamil speaking parts of southern states of India as well as Sri Lanka. There was this fear of this kind of Tamil secessionism all the way up to the late 20th. Paradoxically, at the same time, Tamil Nadu in many ways by the 1990s entered the national mainstream. The DMK and the All India Government of Assam, the DMK and the AIADMK, have been decisive at the center in the era of coalition governments, and as parties representing the OBCs in a post-modern age, see themselves as participating in a nationwide community of assertive backward castes. So the reason why I went into these kinds of instances is so that we won't fall into the trap of thinking that there are certain two, in fact, key pressure points for India, that is the Northeastern Kashmir region alone, and otherwise the Indian nation state is doing fine. The point is that there are several simultaneous levels at which non-nationalism, sub-nationalism, cross-nationalism manifest themselves. And this is a healthy thing for a nation state. It's healthy if there are these kinds of debates and discussions and continuous challenges that are being posed across these identities, and I'm suggesting that that makes a nation a living thing. Don't kill it with some idea imposed from above. That the nation remains living if it is a daily medicine. Now, as far as the states of the northeastern Kashmir are concerned, the history of the accession of many of these to India is too well known, also to narrate, especially to this gathering. So we know that, to take two examples, Manipur was forced into a merger with India in 1949, and under the hybrid agreement between the Naga National Council and British administration, Nagaland was granted protected status for 10 years, and Union of political entities. We know this very well. So the point, however, is that many certain groups of the Northeast therefore insist that they're not secessionist movements, as you know. Because they assert rather that Assam, say, or Manipur or Nagaland were never part of it. So secession suggests that you were once part of a unity and you're seceding. But of course the argument made by many of the groups in the SED and the two groups is that they're not seceding, they consider themselves to be independent struggles for self-determination against the occupying army of a colonial force. One of the crucial measures that enables the Indian state to keep under control the incendiary situation in the Northeast, of course, is the Armed Forces Special Powers Act. passed in 1958, which, as Vimala Kaitan puts it, is an act of legitimizing the involvement of the military in the domestic space. And you all know that he was actually the person, Vimala was the person who pointed out that it is India's national because it was passed on the 11th of September 1958. The key issue here, which links up to our second point of entry into this, so you remember that I'm talking about counter-nationalism and resistance to something called development. So I want to now move into that second issue to the Northeast, which the second point of entry into the question of reimagining is that the centralized exploitation of natural resources in the Northeast for a national level frame. A long history of land acquisition by the Indian state for private tea estates, for the extraction of petroleum, uranium and natural gas, defense installations, and as well as generally low levels of economic development of the neighboring region, has led to two phenomena. One, very high levels of migration into India's northeast from other parts of India and from across the border, particularly Bangladesh. The immigration is of two kinds, of laborers. Bangladeshi immigrants are largely illegal and mainly laborers. I'm going to come back to this idea of illegal immigration in a minute. So one kind of immigration is that, the other kind of immigration into the area is the educated middle classes, the latter forming powerful immigrant communities, for example, Bengalis in Assam. The second phenomenon, so the first is high levels of immigration into the area, the second phenomenon is the gradual transfer of land from the indigenous people to the wealthier countries. Thus, the claim to indigenous identity has come to play a central role in the politics of this region because of the need to lay claim to local resources. Every successive immigrant group, whether laborers, plantation owners, or North Indian and Bengali middle classes, inevitably therefore are perceived as a threat to the culture and to the political and economic fate of indigenous people. Different groups assert different dates as cutoffs to establishing their name. The British Burma Treaty of 1826, the year of independence 47, the date of the first census 1951. Whatever the date for which recognition by the Indian state is sought, those who come after that date are defined as aliens. And ethnic conflict, as we know, has become practically endemic in the region. Many conflicts, such as the Naga-Kuti conflict or the Naga-Mite conflict, are all about land, exclusive control over depleted resources, which are being extracted from the national level, and land increasingly becomes the only reliable long-term priority. Similarly, you know that the claim to a greater homeland for the Naga peoples to bring all Naga-dominated areas of the Northeast under one administrative mechanism comes from conflict. Other ethnic groups in Assam, Manipur, and Arunachal Pradesh, which resisted this expansion of the NSCI. On the other hand, the Indian government's decision to recognize Nabarnam de facto through the extension of the ceasefire agreement is seen as an attempt to further dissension among ethnic groups in the Northeast. So I'm now moving into an overall critique of nationalism per se, because it's not as if there's, in my understanding, that there's a good nationalism and a bad nationalism. When counter-nationalism flees into xenophobic nationalism, that is also an issue that we should take seriously. So you can see these ways in which these ethnic identities are built. In Meghalaya, the politics of Khasi identity emerged during the Assam movement, and the anti-foreign and thrust of the movement was taken up by the Khasi Students Union, but the focus was also on non-Khasis in general. I'm just giving some examples that may be. In the 1980s and 90s, KSU led agitations around the core issue of the control of economy, quality and land by the natives of Meghalaya, the Khasis, as they call themselves. Naturally, this aroused suspicion and fear among other tribes of Meghalaya, the gentile tribes, and non-tribal communities living in the state. So I'm just talking about KSU here as an illustration of a particular kind of xenophobic tenor of much of the politics, or some of the politics in this region. For example, there's a continuous pressure to check what is called illegal immigrants, and this often takes, as we know, the form of Islamophobia, because it is assumed that these illegal immigrants are Muslims from Bangladesh. So that's one kind of thing. Now, when you look at the statements, for example, of the Northeast Students Organization or the KSU and so on, you actually find that the statements that they often make, and especially when they give certain kinds of remarks to the Indian state, the fears that they express are typical of homogenizing nationalisms on the way to becoming nation states. So, for example, this is a phrase from a statement by UNESCO. The sheer number of illegal immigrants in all the northeastern states threatens to undermine our society, social, cultural, economic, and above all, politically. Immigrants marrying local Naga girls and the children of such marriages pose a serious threat to Naga life. The statement also claims that Myanmarese ethnic Muslims who enter Mizoram are responsible for, quote, 80% of the crimes committed in the states. And the KSU has been actively involved in eviction drives of Bangladeshi nationals in 2006. NESU demanded the scrapping of the Indo-Nepal Friendship Treaty, which it claimed was a cover for illegal immigration. Thus, it seems that movements in the region are replicating the logic of the nation state and the notion of the sanctity and integrity of national borders, the very logic against which their struggles began in the first place. What Sanjay Bhavara argues is that the management of conflict in the Northeast has meant increasingly policy interventions under the guidance of international funding agencies like the International Fund for Agriculture. The new transformative concept promoted by transnational donor agencies is ethnobotanical. Supposedly a model that addresses the specificities of ethnic cultures and encourages them to join the global market. In this region, ending the practice of gene cultivation is one of the goals. This effectively means the ending of community ownership of gene land, understood by bureaucrats to be incompatible with any form of national agriculture, and the institution of individual property rights. The outcome is bound to be greater inequality between people who speak one ethnic community, apart from accentuating inequality less and more powerful, more numerous or powerful groups. Similarly, we know that experiments in coffee, tea and rubber cultivation were initiated in the 1980s by the Indian government, which consolidated lands for plantations by getting villagers to pool in common land, which was then placed under the supervision of a manager, usually a non-territory. In the late 1990s, when the prices of coffee fell in the global market, the government bodies withdrew, leaving most plantations to project. In this background, the limitations of what Sanjeev Barua has called the homelandist imagination, which is what I think we need to think about transcending, the homelandist imagination among counter-nationalist movements must be addressed. Barua makes an argument for an alternative institutional imagination, which would disentangle identity from a territorially and ethnically rooted collectivity. He urges that the ethnic homelands of the region be dismantled by giving citizenship rights to the large numbers of quote-unquote illegal immigrants, and more importantly, that the Northeast develop its relationship with its eastern neighbors, because as we all know, the Northeast of India is the southwest of, at 90% of Asia, and not 90% of the borders are international. Currently, such an alternative imagination is not the dominant vision visible on the neither of the Indian state, certainly not of the Indian state, but neither of the insurgent movement. What or who is the illegal migrant, after all? The migrant represents the phenomenon of movement of populations that have been widespread and common over the globe for several hundreds of years. This movement has been both voluntary, so you have seafaring traders, pastoral nomads, invading armies that end up settling the lands they conquer, and forced. Slave trade, indentured labor, prolonged plantations. Once the nation state system was put into place, however, such movements came under scrutiny, that is, movements of people, which was completely natural for centuries, suddenly becomes a focus of suspicion. And from approximately the early 20th century, migration began to be closely linked to the issue of the security, not of people, but of nation states. Dandi Samadha points out that what is called migration is actually a continuation of natural human flows through the centuries, suddenly rendered illegal by new national borders. Sri Lankan fishermen, fisher people have always fished in the ocean. Suddenly they cross the invisible line and they are arrested. And farmers or cattle, people who keep cattle, the cattle have always wandered back and forth. But suddenly there's a border and it becomes a thing. So you're criminalizing daily human activities of people. So it's suddenly rendered illegal by new national borders. What now requires to be called new rights, that is now there are movements to think about new rights, such as the right to move across national borders for trade or work or for grazing of animals, they are not new rights, but they are simply the re-legitimation of old practices. So there are movements that demand these rights, they're actually using the language of new rights, but they, what they're doing is trying to assert much older practices. Now, in the context of Africa, Mahmoud Hamdani has argued that the notion of citizens' rights as attached to place of birth, this which we take for granted, right? We take for granted that citizenship refers to place of birth. But what Mahmoud Hamdani has been arguing in the context of move, dynamic movements of people, the polity makes you feel disenfranchised. So Hamdani makes a very radical argument, contrary to nationalist wisdom, that cultural communities rooted in a common past do not necessarily have a common future. Political communities, rather, he says, should not be defined by a common past, but by the resolve for a common future under a single political rule. He believes, therefore, that citizenship rights should be attached to place of labor, not birth. When you work, you should have rights, not when you work. In short, we need to escape from Hernandez's imaginations that restrict our equitable rights. So this was the first kind of challenge to the nation state, which comes in our process. Let me now come to the second kind of resistance to the project of the nation state, and in the human context that is opposing what is called development. The utterly unsustainable policy of the Indian state under development, a policy strongly backed by the individuals and a deeply implicated corporate English media, its striking feature is its calm callousness towards the powers. Its commitment towards its supposedly abstract goal, development, is revealed to be a commitment to very concrete, specific groups who benefit at the expense of the majority of the population. Most alarming of all is its myopia, its short-sightedness towards the global conditions. Such a policy of development is inaugurated at independence, a policy of intelligent capitalist industrialization through big dams and power projects, and large-scale extraction of natural resources, including uranium mining for nuclear energy. Since independence, development projects of the five-year plans have displaced about 500,000 people each year, primarily as a consequence of land acquisition by the state. And these mega projects have not delivered on their promise, and many of them are being reassessed. For instance, reassessing Bhakra Dam, which Nehru called the temple of modern India, a 2005 study by T.J. Remember that the Bhakra Dam displaced 100,000 people. A study led by Sripad Dharmadikari reveals that the Bhakra Dam played in fact a relatively small role in India's green revolution. Other factors, highly crop varieties, chemical fertilizers and pesticides played a much larger role. The irrigation required for this did not come from the inadequate, unreliable and limited supply of canal water to the land, which was not in fact conducive to intensive farming with new seeds. Groundwater-based irrigation that was crucial. Proponents of the Bhakra Dam often argue that the rise in groundwater irrigation has been made possible due to groundwater recharge from seepage from Bhakra's canals, but in fact, most of the water for tubewells comes from groundwater mined from reserves underground. Why do you think one of the highest levels of farmer suicide is in the Punjab? The green revolution has run its course. The water is depleted, groundwater is depleted, soil is depleted. Groundwater mining now constitutes around 50% of Punjab and Haryana's irrigation. The increase in tubewell-based water mining has resulted in a drastic fall in groundwater levels. The extensive chemical fertilizer use, that is, with high-intensity, you know, high living varieties and that kind of thing, requires very, very intensive chemical fertilizer use. As well as the cropping pattern dominated by high yield rice and wheat dominated by the green revolution, have destroyed the soils. Today, farmers are struggling to pay ever-increasing prices for agricultural inputs and electricity for pumping water, while having to cope with declining agricultural returns. Large numbers of farmers are trapped in debt and the suicide rate among farmers in Punjab and Haryana is much. What is called development is made possible by large-scale land acquisition by the state. Earlier, it used to be for what was called public purpose, so public sector land, you know, nuclear plants. But increasingly, land is being cheaply acquired by the state for private corporations to build their factories.
Yes.
And this is a feature that is specific to the 1990s when the neoliberal phase of the Indian economy emerges. The entry of private companies into arenas where earlier it was the state that had the sole right. Today, private corporations benefit from government support of various kinds, with the government acquiring lands cheaply and by force from peasants and drivers, making them available to these companies at hugely subsidized rates. In the face of protest, the corporations get the full backing of the forces that are made of the state, such as, for example, the legal principle that enables the state to do this is the principle of eminent domain, that is, the right of the state to decide on what is in the common good. Now, it's important to note that the principle of eminent domain is in principle a measure that can and has been used, for redistributive measures, like land reforms, for example. But today, the principle of eminent domain is largely deployed in order to dispossess communities from common property resources and to transform the commons into private. Where private property has been acquired, it has been that of small and medium farmers for which cash compensation is invariably given at less than the prevailing market. So this is also interesting. If you want to really build capitalism and let it flourish, if that is your ambition, let the corporations negotiate with the farmers directly. Why is the state acting as a middleman to acquire the cheap and giving? Let them live. Let it be market rates. That's still not fair because land appreciates in value. So even if corporations pay market rates today, it will still not be just compensation because in 10 years the value of that land will go up. So there's also a move. Sometimes that the farmers or tribals who are dispossessed of their land want not only market rates, they also want shares in the companies. You see, so if you want to do capitalism, do it. Why should the state act as the middleman, the agent of capital? What critics have also been pointing out is that cash compensation doesn't really resolve anything. Law is constructed on the assumption of the individual dislocated person. But there is no understanding of communities as the subjects of dislocation or of ways of life that are destroyed. So there is an abyss of incomprehension on the part of the Indian elites towards rural and tribal communities. Ripping these out from land that they have occupied for generations and transplanting them overnight into an alien setting, which is usually an urban slum, is understood as rehabilitation. And in fact, you find several bureaucrats saying we are liberating them from their backward ways of life. They were just tribals and now they are living in the city in a slum. The more fundamental question though is whether cash adequately compensates for land. The sudden access to large amounts of cash is something that requires a particular training in market behavior to deal with advantages. You have to be an urban person with some history of at least a second generation urban person with cash income to know what you can do with that cash. All these, for example, the big utility vehicles that you see all over Delhi, or if you ever drive in Gurgaon or UP, and you find these fast driving young men, etc. It's all the result of cash compensation for land. You don't know what to do with the cash because you were in an agriculture community and overnight you have a huge amount of money. So the idea that you invest, you think of, it's a culture, it has to be learned, right? That self-interest maximizing individual is not a natural creature. In fact, it doesn't exist at all. It has to be produced with great difficulty, and when you produce it with great difficulty, the supreme example of it is Malaya. That is what the self-interest maximizing individual looks like, which is Malaya. That's what it looks like, right? So is that the ambition or? What happens is that study after study of dislocated communities conducted by independent groups has found that even in the case of settled urban populations, so for example, even industrial workers who've been given cash packages in voluntary retirement schemes, immediate access to cash leads to dissipation in things like medical expenses, marriages, and so on. The particular cultural sensibility required to make the most of cash is even more starkly lacking among most of the communities that get displaced, more than half of which comprise tribal populations, because it's their lands which have the resources that the populations need. Most of them have had limited interaction or familiarity with the capitalist market. So for example, I'm citing one report that India visited, People's Union for Democratic Rights, visited the resettlement site of tribal people replaced by an alumina mining company in Odisha in 2005, and they found, I quote, an overwhelming sense of depression and bewilderment. It's just heartbreaking, right, to think of this. It's bewilderment. How did this happen? Why are we here? with inadequate drinking water. Most of the hand pumps installed were not in working order. This is in their great rehabilitation site. They were in a land where there's plenty of water, enough livelihood. They're dumped in a place where there's inadequate drinking water. Most of the hand pumps were not in working order. They've lost their land and means of livelihood, lost their access to forests and forest produce. If they step in and pick up a leaf, they're breaking a law. The Forest Act. Forest produce and land for grazing cattle, they were at a loss. The cash they had been given seemed to have been thrown away, either in legitimate expenses or in many cases that office. With no prospect of jobs in the companies, for the majority of them, they are basically faced with the end of the road. Now, there's another provision that is sometimes cited or offered for compensation, which is land for land. Now, this is a completely mythical claim. Land for land. Why is that not possible? Because first of all, of course, it excludes the vast majority who have only customary and not formal rights to land. If you are supposed to be given land for land, you have to show up at that. And customary rights to land don't have that. But this issue isn't enough land to resettle the enormous number who have been dislocated and who continue deservedly to swell their ranks. The Madhya Pradesh government already declared sometime in the late 20s, I mean around the late 90s, that it declared in the Supreme Court it cannot provide land to the hundreds of thousands displaced by the Bagi Dam in 1990 and by the dams on the way. The Supreme Court in its judgment on the Sardar Sarovar in 2000 held that displacement per se does not constitute violation of fundamental rights. Remember, this is the elite. This is what they see. Some poor backward travelers who should all. So they think that when they talk about it, they talk about these poor backward travelers are suddenly, you know, enjoying the beauty malls of Delhi, right? So in 2000, the Supreme Court held that displacement per se does not constitute violation of fundamental rights, since at the rehabilitation sites, the Supreme Court said, I quote, there will be better facilities than in the tribal habits. Moreover, the judgment said it is very good that tribals should be gradually assimilated into the mainstream forces. Or as officials of the Central Water Commission put it at a seminar on the Sardar Sarovar, displacement from land is crucial for releasing labor for industry. This is the real reason. This is what Marx talks about in Capital Volume 1. This is what happened in England in the 16th and 17th centuries. Releasing people from the land. Actually, what are you doing? It sounds like they're tied helplessly to the land. We didn't want to be tied there. What you're really doing is dispossessing peasantry from the land, throwing them into the labor market, creating the proletariat. That's what you're doing because you want cheap wage labor. This is a key element of capitalist transformation everywhere, historically. And they said it. You don't have to read Marx now. You can listen to the officials of the Central Water Commission saying that it is absolutely crucial for releasing labor for industry. Whose interest is it to release labor for industry? Why should I be released from my land so that industry can have labor? So this is the capitalist project, right? And indeed, we can be sure that the vast majority of those ripped out from forests and the land, and remember, all of this is being done in the name of the Indian nation and India, and the interest of India, and Indian interest. This continuous invocation of India in all of this. So we can be sure that the vast majority of those ripped out from forests and the land will end up as debris in urban slums, periodically flushed out from the city, only to come trickling back again to build the roads and flyovers, and to perform the myriad tasks that keep the city alive. Now, what about the resistance to being dispossessed? There is a long history of struggles, especially of tribal peoples against being dispossessed by the state, going back to the colonial period. But there is one crucial difference. All struggles from the late 19th century to 1947 that survive in memory do so by being accommodated into the history of anti-imperialist struggles. Right? We see all these struggles as anti-imperialist. So they have some status. They were in fact struggles against being dispossessed by the state. They were not necessarily saying, "Don't live in India." In fact, they didn't. But up to 1947, these struggles are taken as part of the national struggle by historians and by post-colonial elites. But with the coming of independence, any such assertions instantly transformed into an anti-national act. The overwhelming legitimacy of the anti-imperialist struggle and of the newborn nation state was successful in deleting from history over 2,000 families displaced by the Pakhranagar Dam in the 1950s, of which less than half had been resettled in the 25 years. Those displaced by the Hirakud Dam linger in national memory only because they were the audience for their
disturbing words to them. If you want to suffer, you should suffer in the interest of the country. 200,000 people were displaced by the Pangram in 1964. In the absence of any resettlement program, tens of thousands of them ended up on the banks of the reservoir, settling there and cultivating the land exposed when the reservoir receded in the summer. Now, one displacement of these people by the Pangram. The same people were displaced by the Singhalli thermal power plant, third round by the coal mines. In successive waves of industrialization, the same sets of people were displaced. And finally, they were displaced for the worst insult of all, for compensatory afforestation. Imagine, you were driven away from your forests, and now you have to be driven away because forests have been planted where you have been displaced. Basically, displacing people uprooted several times over in order to placate nature for the damage that has been done. The period since the late 1980s, however, has seen growing resistance to such policies by dispossessed groups in different parts of the country. Thus, continued pressure from the movements in India and international solidarity actions resulted in the withdrawing of funds from the Mahesha Dam on the Narmada by the German government and by US and German corporations. In June 2006, the Environment Ministry directed Madhya Pradesh government to stop all work on the dam, pending a credible and comprehensive rehabilitation plan. In 2012, the MP government decided to terminate the power purchase agreement with the private company that was supposed to run it. This is one victory, but it's not like, but there was one small victory. The point is that increasingly the dispossessed, because what has happened is in the 50s and 60s, we didn't even think of that there were people displaced by the Pangram. But now we know, because there is increasingly a marked aversion to going quietly into it. There have been organized and increasingly militant struggles of varying degrees of efficacy. They're not all successful because something is something as powerful as the Indian state. But we know from Kudankulam against the nuclear power plant where 400 cases of sedition have been lodged against those who complained, those who protested against Kudankulam. Haryana farmers in Haryana and rest of the world. Then we know that in 2013, in 2013, the decades-old movement of the tribal Rohingya clans against the mining in the nearby region successfully resulted in a directive by the Supreme Court to conduct an environmental referendum in which the tribal council voted to stop the mining company Vedanta from carrying out its mining activities. Recently, meaning in the last, I'm actually not exactly sure of the year, but I think a couple of years ago, 3-4 years ago, the state government of Nagaland claimed the right to control its oil resources and independently invite expressions of interest from corporations. At the same time, invoking community rights to natural resources for the past 3 decades, the Lokha Naga people have been struggling against the state-owned giant oil and natural gas corporation, which has been exploring and extracting oil and gas from their land. Their struggle is a fight both against the company's violation of their right to control and manage their natural resources, well as against the complicity of the government of Nagaland. This movement of the Lokha Naga faces larger questions of ecological sustainability and relationship with indigenous people with the ecosystem that they have. So in my concluding section, I'm going to move into what the radical transformative politics must look like. We have considered 2 axes of contestation of the logic of the Indian nation state. I would like to conclude by placing before you 2 alternative ideas. The post-national as an ethical horizon and degrowth, D-E-G-R-O-W-K, degrowth as an economic and social political goal. Any radical transformative politics today must be post-national. In the way it has been developed by a group of South Asian scholars, including myself, the post of post-nationalism is to be understood not in the sense of after, but in the sense of having passed through the nation. In the idea of the post-national, that is, having passed through, been there, done that. In the idea of the post-national, the insistence on an uncompromising critique of the nation is not an argument for post-nationalism from above, which has been made from 2 opposed positions. So our idea of the post-national is not either of these 2 arguments that I'm about to make, which is one in which the sovereignty of the nation is sought to be bypassed in the interest of global capital. We're not talking about post-national in that sense. We're also not talking about post-national in the sense of Habermasian celebration of global universalism. global universalism. Because both of these are actually, both these ideas of post-national actually posit a dominant identity, either capital or Europe, as the alternative to nation. The kind of so I'm calling this post-nationalism from afar. The kind of post-nationalism I'm referring to, or I'm placing before you, is better described as being from below. Its politics can be represented by any idea that is counter-hegemony. Whether that hegemony refers to development, whether it's a development hegemony, a sexuality hegemony, a caste hegemony, or a community hegemony. But equally importantly, it must be seen as having two dimensions. One is over the nation, across national borders. And two is under the nation, resisting inclusion into the what is called the larger national identity. Insisting on space and time trajectories that do not mesh the progressivist dominant narratives of nation. So this over the nation is in a sense easier to recognize as a subversive strategy because it begins with the assumption of existing nations which then interrupts. So this can include cross-border solidarity for feminist movements, anti-nuclear movements, peace movements. The other dimension of post-national politics under the nation is less obvious as a strategy because it does not presume the prior existence of the nation. More significantly, its subversive edge may lie in the exact opposite of what animates the politics of over the nation. That is the strategy of exit and movement across borders. So one kind of subversiveness is across borders, right? Exit, movement across borders. But the interrogation, so that what I'm trying to say is it's not one, post-nationalism is not one thing. It is from under, but it can mean across, it can mean over the nation, across national borders, but it can also mean under the nation. And the subversive edge of this under the nation could, the interrogation of this sort may involve the refusal to move. So rather than saying we will move across borders, it could be the refusal to move, as for example, in the struggles against big dams. What is the big slogan of the NDA? Hum nahi hatenge, baandh nahi. Hum nahi hatenge. Right? So we will not move. So refusal to move, Apudangula, for example. So movement across borders is also one kind of post-national strategy. Refusal to move is also a kind of post-national strategy. What is what in common between them? The articulation of a counter-hegemonic idea. So struggles against big dams or mining operations that involve massive relocation of populations, the struggle of tribals for control over their natural resources. This dimension may also involve claiming histories that run parallel to and do not intersect with those of the nation. So for example, in Gujarat after 2002 massacre of Muslims under the protection of the state authorities, I met a woman called Zubeda in a camp, a refugee camp, after she had destroyed everything she had been destroyed. She owned a small abandoned business which had been destroyed. In the shade of the neem protecting her, the dalga, there was a neem tree and the dalga that was where the camp for. She was chatting to me about Delhi where she has relatives and she said she's not from Gujarat originally. So I said, where are you from? And this is what she said to me, Vindravan where you home. Now she says Vindravan for Vindavan. Which is all, now you can say it is a wrong form, it's an apabhramsh of Vindavan. But I think we need to think of these as vocal articulations of names, right? I mean there's no one correct substantive form. Vindravan is actually the way which Vrindavan's very old, she asked me. I said no. So she said, Tirathkar mein nahi gaye, because she knew I was Hindu. Tirathkar mein nahi gaye, you should go for pilgrimage. Hum wahi se hain. And then she said, the most astonishing thing, wahi hamara vatan. Vrindavan is her vatan. Right? So this is an idea of a home, homeland, which is very different from a nationalist homeland. She had to leave Vrindavan, which she loved, for livelihood. And of course now she has no livelihood. But the way in which she spoke about Vrindavan, hum wahi se hain, wahi hamara vatan. Hamara vatan is not India, Pakistan, which is what the Hindu right would have said, right, that she should take away from Pakistan. For this Muslim woman, Zubeda, the vatan was Vrindavan, Vrindavan, the land of Krishna. She did not identify with India. She identified with the locality. The post-national involves the recognition and valuing of these multiple histories and identities. And the second idea that I want to place before you is deep global. An idea that formally emerged in Southern Europe in 2008, but with roots which go back to the 1970s. Deep global And if you look up degrowth online, you'll find a number of sites which talk about it. It's a growing movement in Europe. Degrowth is a downscaling of production and consumption to increase human well-being and enhance ecological conditions and equity on the planet. In other words, economic activity must not exceed the carrying capacity of the planet and it should promote human well-being, not the avaricious pursuit of wealth. Obviously, this would have a specific meaning in the context of the global north, quite different from how it would play out in the global south. But we do need to remember that there are extremely poor people in the global north and incredibly wealthy people in the global south. The importance of the idea of degrowth is that it delegitimizes the idea of natural and endless growth, subscribed to in the south not only by elites but even by leftists. The idea of degrowth is thus radically anti-systemic and anti-development. The idea of post-national and degrowth-oriented perspectives recognize the local as a legitimate space of assumption, imply a move to participatory forms of democracy, with all the uncertainties that these shifts imply. For this uncertainty is more ethical than the rigid certainties